Plentiful. Hallelujah. Last week, we brushed through what are the cultural meaning of harvest. When you plant seed or you plant stem, you plant something into the ground, and after some season is over, you begin to bring the reward of what you have labored upon. And we mentioned about different types of plants, different types of crops. There are some crops you plant, in 3 months you will harvest. There are some you plant, in 6 months you will harvest. There are some you plant, in a year you harvest. There are some you plant, 5 years you harvest. Hallelujah! Sometimes when I ask God, why is it taking so long for me to reap my harvest? The Lord said, what you are planting is not just ordinary. What you are planting this 100 years. So what you are planting is going to take time to take root. Hallelujah! So what exactly are we planting? The type of seed we put in the soil will determine what is going to come out for you. I will tell you your time of harvest. If you plant with nodules within 5 seconds, 5 minutes, 10 minutes, you get it done. But if you are planting proper things like mango, guava, it takes 3, 4, 5 years. Hallelujah. I'm talking literally in a dramatic expression. Nodules is a kind of food. You can easily, the microwave food that you can just quickly get it and done. Okra is 3 months. Maize, within 6 months, you get proper maize. Hallelujah. But when you want to plant fruits like cassava takes like 18 months or 2 years for proper harvesting. You want to plant mango or guava and orchard, you can't just get things easily. It takes time. So when you're asking God, oh God, where is my harvest, my testimony? The Lord is taking time to prepare that testimony. Don't rush God. God wants you to wait because the harvest is going to be plentiful. Hallelujah. So we went through that one, and we let us know what God, Jesus Christ, was talking about when he said the harvest is plentiful. Jesus was talking about us serving, being minded of the kingdom of God. Hallelujah. And right now we are going to continue on that chapter. Hallelujah. We are still on the text, Matthew chapter 9, from verses 35 to 38. I'll quickly read through so that we can understand what exactly God is talking about. When did Jesus Christ say, behold, the harvest is plentiful? And why did he say that? What brought about the situation? And Jesus went about all the cities and villages. Like we went this morning on the church of the street. Why did we have to go? What prompted me that I can't sleep in my house? I have this passion and burden that somebody might die today. And if they hear the word on the street today, they might be changed. And even if they die, they will get to heaven. What kept boiling in me that I find it hard to sleep? Sometimes when I'm tired, I remember when Apostle said, woe is me if I do not preach the gospel. Why is it that so many Christians today, we can't find them on the street preaching the gospel anymore? It's not only evangelism. God has made every Christian evangelist to be preaching. That is why I get my children involved actively in this evangelism. Letting them know, you are not preaching for me. You are not serving me. Whatever you do, it's not going to come into my own account when you get to heaven. It will go into your own account. Ma, when you go to work and you are paid, do they pay the money to my account? No. Why? Because you are the one that labored. You have to get the reward. So likewise, it works in the kingdom of God. Jesus was going about his father's business. He went to villages. He was teaching at the synagogues. He was preaching the gospel everywhere. And he was healing the oppressed, healing the sick. That was all the primary assignment of Jesus. Even when he was hungry and he sat by the well, he was physically hungry. He was still preaching the gospel. How many? This is the same way God wants us to be hungry for him. He has gone now. And when he saw the multitude, after he has healed the sick, people were still rushing and trooping, coming to Jesus. I'm reading from Matthew chapter 9, verse 35 to 38. He was moved with compassion. My actually. She will turn my hair over and make a new style for me. That is her passion. My other daughter, she can draw you life. That is her passion. What you have passion for, you can spend hours there, not even observing the time, isn't it? So, God, Jesus was passionate when he saw people. And there was no other people to help Jesus. Even the apostles, the disciples. And because they were fainted, they were scattered abroad. There was nobody to take care of them. Verse 37, then said he unto his disciples, that is when Jesus can have said, the harvest is truly plentiful. And now in that generation, the harvest is truly plentiful. There was a day on the field when we were preaching, I met some Muslim guys, his family. Sincerely speaking, this man was hungry, spiritually hungry, curious, wanting to know about Jesus. Because we were privileged to be born again. Some were not. Some were born in some religion that they cannot get out. But they are looking for the truth. They are looking for the way. I can see some expression of some people. When I'm out there, I have seen Muslims jumping up for me in the car when I'm preaching the gospel. Souls are hungry out there. And sometimes when I'm preaching, I begin to cry. Because there are no people out there to come and preach the gospel anymore. People are so shy, they're so afraid, they don't understand the word of God because Jesus already told us that he is with us. The moment you make up your mind that you want to go and preach the gospel, automatically the Lord has increased the angels that are going with you. Because it is not your business anymore, it is the business of God you are going for. You can't go for the business of God and God will not protect you. And Jesus has said, that is why the prayer comes, we are going to come to pray. Pray ye therefore the Lord of harvest that he will send forth laborers into his vineyard. Everybody seated here, we are all laborers. Every church is
in Nottingham today,
we are all laborers. Not pastors, evangelists, apostles, we are all laborers. Don't be too heavy headed and say you can't go out to preach. We are all supposed to go out and minister the gospel. Let me tell you something. When we go out to for leaflets, flyers, they don't take leaflets more from, they take it more from the children. And whoever knows who will take the leaflet and will read it and give their life to Christ. Because the prayer of salvation is in that flyer. Basically, Jesus was talking to his disciples. In quick, we are one of his disciples today. Are we not Jesus' disciples? Are we not Christians? What is the meaning of Christian? We are followers of Christ.
In as
much as you say you are followers of Christ, you believe in the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ, and you are baptized, then you are automatically entitled to be a preacher. You are automatically entitled to go there and bring some soul to God. What am I talking about? Your uncles are there, they are not here. Your cousins, your sisters, your brothers, your neighbors, your friends. I'm passionate about souls. I don't know about others. When somebody tells me that somebody is dying, somebody died, the person that comes to my mind is the person is dead. Is the person who will make it to heaven? That is the person that comes into my heart. So, there was a day I was coming from work, and the Lord was telling me I should go on that hook, on that eye pavement. It was raining heavily. And I said, God, what is raining? What did go there and preach? Are you telling me that people will not die on a rainy day? I listened. I looked so stupid. When I got there, I said, okay, Lord, what should I say? I don't just open, but what should I say? And the Lord said, and the Lord was giving me some songs that have to be raining. It is raining all around me. I can't feel it. Who died that day? I don't know who died that day. I don't know who died.
because my own is to just cut up the seed. And the seed will go on a good ground by God's will. And the Lord only to perfect the seed. There was a day we were preaching at the city, and they told my sister, Mr. Benson, I'll never forget that man's name. He was in his 60s. And immediately, only thing prompted me, speak to this man. I did one of him, and I came to him. Next week, we'll be going more on training. How you and I can preach without any stuff. And only three talked, prompted me. This man that is coming, he was smoking. He was in his 60s. His name is Mr. Benson.
And I went to him, I said, good morning, sir. God bless you, sir. Can I ask you a question? I started ministering to him. Do you believe within 5-10 minutes, this man started weeping? And I asked him, what do you want God to do for you today? If Jesus Christ is passing by right now in front of you, what will you want Jesus to do for you? And the man looked at me. He said, I want to stop smoking. And I just prayed one little prayer with him. Because it's not my job, it's God's business. I am an ambassador of Christ. I'm just representing God, and I'm ready. And the only thing will flow through me to the man. I touched the man. Can I touch you? I touched the man. And right there, he dropped the cigarette and he started crying. And he looked at me. Truly, the Lord has sent you to me. And he gave his life there. Right in there, he gave his life. But since then, to my surprise, I've never seen this man. Maybe that night, the man died. And I was the only hope. And imagine I was not there to preach the gospel. The man could have died and gone to hell. And Jesus was compassionate about people going to hell every day. And he saw people were there in mystery. Their souls are deserving. And Jesus was full of compassion. And he said, oh, the harvest is plentiful. Let us pray to the Lord of Ireland to bring laborers. We are the laborers. Play your part. It doesn't matter who mocks you. It doesn't matter who thinks you are foolish. But let me tell you, the Lord the rewarder is going to reward you greatly.
Amen.
Yama Shantara. The God is looking about for employers to work in. Jesus is looking for employers to work in his Father's company. So that he can bring harvest to him. Remember when Jesus' spirit was looking for him when he was 12 years old and he went to Jerusalem? Listen to this. In the book of John chapter 5, Jesus did not return with his parents. When Mary and Joseph realized that he was missing, they went back to Jerusalem to look for him. They found him in the synagogue preaching, and he told them that, why are you searching for me? He asked them, didn't you know I must be about my Father's business? Jesus did not take his Father's business for last granted. As early as the age of 12, that is why I am making my children to understand. Listen, mommy is not crazy. It is what the Lord said we should do. Among everything that we do on earth, the most important thing Jesus wants us to do is to win soul for him. Because that was his primary assignment. He came to save the old world. Now, Jesus has come and he left the company for you. Are you going to make Jesus' company bankrupt? Jesus has made us an ambassador. Are we going to bankrupt the business? So many Christians today, they are bankrupting the business of God by not winning soul. They don't even know you are a Christian at your place of work. At school, they don't know you are a Christian. Because your way of life doesn't even reflect as one. Luke chapter 2, verse 41 to 52. That was where the story came from. Jesus refers to winning soul as his Father's business. He was in synagogue listening, hearing and asking questions with the teacher of the law. By next week, by God's grace, the Lord is going to open our eyes how we can minister easily without any stress. And different type of ways we can minister. Sometimes, some people will be so busy, you can't talk much, just give them the fly. Sometimes all you need is just to, while you are talking, can I touch you? Can I pray with you? And some will say, okay, don't worry, pray with me. And that prayer will be like fire unto them. Some is just a question. Just look around. Only three will put words, what you will say in your mouth. It might be somebody wearing Nike trainers. And the conversation will start on Nike trainers.
And from there, only thing will put words into your mouth and ask about salvation. Something will connect you to Jesus with that person. At least I've been preaching for since when I was 8 years old, and I'm well over 40 now. And every time I go to preach, God is always faithful. Hallelujah. What was Jesus' father's business? What was his father's business? To win souls. To serve in the sanctuary of God. Sometimes, your own assignment might be calling and trying to check on people. Hello, how are you? I'm not saying I should check on you. Are you doing? Are you okay? Can I pray with you? What exactly do you want me to pray with you for? They've come to church once or twice. I will not see them in church. But you are checking on them. That assignment is to ensure that they are established in this house. It's part of winning soul. Part of winning soul might be helping somebody that, you know, maybe you are the one that holds the company, and if they come to church and they don't have a job, you can help. When you know God has given the capacity, is to make sure that everybody is happy. We are all in one accord. This is not a time where somebody is showing up more than somebody. We are supposed to be equal in the presence of God. When I have 10 pairs of shoes, and you know somebody is wearing one pair of shoes every day, and you know the person has their own size, why can't you just come together with style? If the person is also free, you can give two or three of your pair of shoes out to that person. That person will feel, yes, this is my family. The body of Christ is supposed to be a family thing. Not where you'll be showing up your cushy cushy, maori maori. It is nonsense. I know God's going to bless me with a very comfortable man. If he's just giving me money, I'll be saving the money, I'll be going to Africa. I'll be investing on orphanage children. And that's what I'm going to be doing. You just be saying, I'm weak as you are. I'm sorry, I'm going to disappoint him. I'm telling you the truth. That is my heart. People don't have good water, and I'm wearing Mahuri, Kushi, Lovitron. Doesn't make sense. People are somewhere, they need ordinary water to drink. Uh-huh. And I'm telling you the truth. I will be wearing a wristwatch that is up to £10,000. And that £10,000 can pay somebody's school fees, and that person can become a medical doctor. Am I crazy? No. Let's be real. That is my heart. And that's where I feel about so outside there. And I'm saved. My children are saved by the grace of God. What about their friends in school? There are potential apostles out there. If somebody has not preached to me, I will not be an evangelist today. There are potential prophets out there. Liberals are few. Where are we? We are too big to be on the street to preach the gospel. I don't care what you call me. So far, God is happy with me. He sent an angel yesterday to hug me. I was pouring power and fire into me. I woke up, I was crying. Exactly 3 a.m. I woke up. I said, wow. Because God saw that people around me were discouraging me. And I said, God, have I wrong? Have I done anything wrong? God said, no, I love you. And if God can tell me he loves me, who is man to condemn me? Hallelujah. The heartbeat of God is winning soul. The heartbeat, I want my children to love God more than I do. I know I love God, but I want my children, I cry to God every day, Lord, when I'm gone, let my children serve you more than I serve you. When I'm gone, let them be crazy
for you. That is all I crave for them. Because when they are crazy for God, every other thing will fall in place. You won't need to beg for money. You won't need to beg for people to serve. You won't, because your heartbeat, you are doing the heartbeat of God. Hallelujah. Amen. Jesus knew that he had just 3.5 years to preach the gospel. So he handed the assignment over to his 12 disciples.
bread, basically 120, because it was 120, about 120 that received the Holy Ghost in the book of Acts chapter 1 verse 8. But now all the apostles have died. We are the disciples of today. We are the Christians, we are the ambassador today. Apostle died, John died, Luke died, Peter died. All the other people that are coming after, they died and died. Our forefathers died, they were Christians. But we are the present Christian today. How much missionary journey have we gone to? Okay, you cannot even go on missionary journey, but you are working and got some money. How many missionary assignments are you supporting? Okay, you don't even have money. How many times have you been on your knees praying for pastors? Praying for evangelists out there. Your prayer goes a long way. Sometimes I will just want to mind my business. I want to pray for my children and myself and church. And God will say, you know what? Close that chapter. Pray for this person. I don't need to know the person. The Lord will give you the name. The Lord can bring the picture or give you the name. Pray for this person right now. He's in the hospital. Pray for this right now. Is this. Pray for. So, you know, God already bring the prayer. What? Who I want to pray for and when, what I want to pray for about? God can bring persecuted Christians. They were preaching and they are put in prison because of Christ. Maybe your prayer alone will save them and the prison gate will be opened and they will set free. Just like when Peter was in prison. You are need to ask God now, how can I serve? How do I need to serve? Where do I need to serve? But how can I preach the gospel? You might ask, I don't even know how to preach. What do I need to know about winning souls and serving faithfully in God's kingdom? The first thing that you must avoid is avoid fear to set in. Don't ever be afraid of opening your mouth to preach. You have to ask Holy Spirit to help you. Remember that Jesus said, he's with us anytime we go to preach. Angels are with us when we go out to preach. They are there to protect us from all evil. Mark chapter 16 verse 20. When they went forth and preached everywhere, the Lord walking with them, confirming the word with signs and wonders. So God has promised us that he's with us until the end of time. So if God says he's with us, why are we afraid? And another thing we need to do is that we have to be thirsty for God. Be hungry for his power. Be hungry for his anointing. Be hungry and be passionate about his kingdom. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. Every other thing will fall in place. When you seek God's kingdom, you will attract men. You will attract money. You will attract glory. You will attract honor. Everything you will attract because you're already seeking God. Everything is in God. Jesus is all you need to have your needs met. And in case of training about evangelism as well, no matter how anointed we are, we still need some training. How do we do one to one? What about if anybody asks questions like this, what do I say? If you don't know it, don't be humble to say, well, I don't know this question. If you like, you can give me your contact number, then we can continue with this. Whatever you know, there was a time a man asked a question, I can't remember. I just said, hold on 1 minute. I just turned like this. I just spoke in tongues. The Lord, please, what should I say? I can't remember the answer. But what I opened my mouth to say, the man said something. Ever since I've been asking questions, you are the only one that has ever answered me satisfactorily. But was it me? No, it was Holy Spirit. So there are some times like that when you are preaching, you just need to ask God for help. And God will bring express answer. So learn to trust God implicitly on God when you go out to preach. Then be constantly be filled with the word. You know you want to go and preach. Get some words about salvation into yourself. Serving the Lord makes God to be partnership with you. And you continuously operate in the supernatural. Because you have signed yourself for God, the Lord will automatically empower you. And he will send angels to protect you as well. Hallelujah. And let us know you can't serve God
and God will never cheat you. Serve God, there is rewards. Not only in heaven, even on earth. There are some people, they are just so angry with some men of God that the Lord has blessed so richly. I just keep on asking, where were you when you were serving God recklessly? Where were you when they were faithfully serving God, and they are still serving God anyway? Now God has turned around to bless them, and some people will be saying, "I'm fathering into so," because they just get angry for being blessed. But they do not read the Bible that when you serve God, the Lord says you shall bless. Exodus 23, verse 25 and 26. And you shall serve the Lord thy God in any capacity. If you know that if God has called you to serve, maybe in the community, in the church, maybe on the street, any capacity God has called you to, and you are serving faithfully, the Lord says, and he shall bless thy bread and water. And he takes all sickness from you. Be busy for Jesus, and he will be busy for your business too. God will protect and preserve all that is yours. When you are busy for God, God will be protecting your children. God will protect you. God will protect your house. God will see that you are financially balanced. When you seek after God's business, all of your business will be taken care of. Now listen. You can pay your tithes. You can pay your offering. You can serve in your church. You can give alms to the poor. You can help the widow. You can send money to the missionaries. You can bless men and women of God. But God still wants you to use your mouth and speak salvation unto your friends, unto aunties, unto uncles, unto cousins, unto neighbors, people that you meet on train, tram, vehicles, on the street. God is counting on you. Will you yield to the calling? Let's be on our feet. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.